إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، after praising Allah سبحانه وتعالى, sending peace and blessings upon His Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, by way of this which was known as the Khutbatul Haja, or the Sermon of Need. And that is that sermon that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to recite when he would begin his addresses, when he would address his companions, when he would address others from among those who he intended to convey the message to, or to discuss with them the message that he had been sent with. And that sermon, it begins by saying, إِنَّ الْحَمْدَ لِلَّهِ. Indeed, all praise is due to Allah. We praise Him, we seek His guidance, and we seek His aid and assistance. And we bear witness that whosoever Allah guides cannot be misguided. And whosoever Allah misguides will not be guided aright. And the Messenger likewise, during that sermon, he would make that statement that we seek refuge in Allah from our evil actions and the evil consequences of our wrongdoings. And then the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, peace and blessings be upon him, he would continue to mention that statement of declaration of faith, and that is the statement that is utilized by every Muslim throughout his life, is uttered. And likewise is the very statement that one utters when he enters into, or she enters into, Islam. And that is that he would say, وَأَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِنَّ اللَّهِ, that I bear witness that there is no Lord and no deity worthy of worship except Allah, the creator of the heavens and the earth, and the God of all of the prophets and the messengers, the God of Abraham, the God of Moses, the God of Jesus, the God of Ismail, the God of Ishaq, the God of Job, the God of Lot, and the God of every single one of the prophets and the messengers that our Lord the Most High has ever sent, the God of Noah, and the God of the righteous men and women past and present. So he would say, I bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah, and that I bear witness that Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, is the final servant and slave of Allah, the messenger of Allah. And that is the final slave and servant and messenger that was sent to mankind by our Lord the Most High after a succession and a string and chain of prophets and messengers all calling to one and the same thing. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the seal, brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, of all of them. And that is that the affair as it relates to our Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that he was no different in essence from the messengers and the prophets that came before. And just as he himself mentioned, al-anbiya'u ikhwatun li'allat dinuhum wahid wa shara'u shatta. He mentioned that indeed the prophets and the messengers are brothers li'allat. And this statement, brothers li'allat, is a statement that refers to brothers who share the same father but have different mothers. So they are half brothers, if you like. And so he mentioned that the prophets are ikhwatun li'allat, deenuhum wahid. Their religion is one, wa shara'i'u shatta. But their legislations, the various rules and regulations that they may have come with, may have differed from time to time, from prophet to messenger. And so, brothers and sisters, when we're speaking about the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we're speaking about an individual who is upon the way of all of those prophets and messengers that came before. We're speaking about Muhammad ibn Abdullah, ibn Abd al-Muttalib, ibn Hisham, that great prophet and messenger, Muhammad, the son of Abdullah, who was the son of Abd al-Muttalib, who was the son of Hisham, whose lineage, brothers and sisters, when we analyze and when we study, goes back to that prophet Abraham. And that is, brothers and sisters, the prophets and the messengers that were sent, no doubt, were many. And the one prophet that is considered the father of the prophets and the messengers is Abraham. Abraham, I'm sure you're aware, had two sons, Ismail and Ishaq. From Ishaq, the prophets and the messengers that we're acquainted with came. Dawood, David, Solomon, Yusuf, Joseph, and so on. All of those prophets and messengers that were mentioned in the Quran and likewise in the Old Testament and the New Testament. And so those prophets and messengers came by way of Ishaq, the son of Abraham. As far as Ismail is concerned, then Ismail, brothers and sisters, we had no prophet and no messenger come from the offsprings of Ismail as we found them coming from the offsprings of Ishaq. Rather, what we saw was that Prophet Abraham was commissioned and was commanded to leave his wife Hajar in the valley of Mecca, which was a barren valley at that time. It was just a valley, desert. He was commissioned to leave her there, and she was left there, brothers and sisters, unaware of how she would receive and obtain sustenance. And then Allah the Most High commanded her to seek for water. And so she spent something from a period of time running between the two mountains that were present within that valley. Two mountains, one of them known as Safa and the other known as Marwa. And then Allah the Most High sent an angel, and some narrations mention that it was the angel Gabriel, who struck the sand in the center of that valley with his wing, and there burst from that the spring that continues to flow to this very day, the spring of Zamzam. And it was on the basis of that that we found the Prophet Ismail and his mother Hajar, that they received sustenance and continued to dwell within that valley, unaware of what it was that was decreed for them. Thereafter, we had that which took place historically at a similar time in Yemen. And that is that the people of Yemen had a catastrophe that took place, and that was that the dam of a place known as Ma'rib in Yemen split. And that dam destroyed many townships, many villages, and cities within Yemen, and so many of the people of Yemen decided to look for other places to dwell. Many of them traveled to various regions around the Arabian Peninsula, and a group of them traveled towards the area of Mecca. And one of the ways that they would know that a land had water within it and was able to live within it was that they would analyze and study the movement of the birds. And if they saw birds moving over a particular region, area, then they would know that there was water there, as the birds generally would move towards those areas that had water. And so they observed that over the area of Mecca. And when they arrived at that region, in that valley, they saw Hajar, the mother of Ismail, and her son Ismail dwelling within that valley. So they sought permission, as was the manner of the Arab at that time, even from a woman who was alone with her mother. They still sought permission from her to dwell in her vicinity or in that region alongside her, and to share with that water that she had and that she was taking sustenance from. And thus we had the people of Yemen and the Arab that were present within Yemen moving to that region, and Ismail married from the people of Yemen. Ismail, the son of Abraham, married from the people of Yemen. And then in essence we had the origins of the Arab as we know them today. Now they were in actuality offsprings of that marriage that took place between Abraham, between Ismail, and between the woman that he married from the tribes of the people of Yemen. And thereafter in that region we saw the tribes and the people of the Arab continuing to procreate and spread within that region, and That continued to be the case up until the birth of that prophet and that messenger Muhammad ibn Abdullah, who was born, brothers and sisters, in the spring of the year of the elephant, a year that was known as the Aam al-Fil. And he was born on a Monday. And he was born likewise in the morning. And his mother, Amina, who was at that time a widow, as she had lost her husband, Abdullah, the father of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, prior to the birth of Muhammad. And so, she gave birth that morning to Muhammad ibn Abdullah, Muhammad the son of Abdullah. And during that time, prior to the birth of Muhammad, she saw dreams. And that she saw on an occasion in a dream that a light had come from her. Some narrations mention from her stomach, and some narrations mention that that light came from between her legs as she was giving birth, that she saw in her dream. And that was the dream that she saw, that she was giving birth, and then a light came from below her, and that light illuminated the region of it spread so far that it illuminated the region of Syria. And so when she gave birth, in reality, in real life, she gave birth to Muhammad, the son of Abdullah. Not knowing that that child was soon to grow to witness that which all of the prophets and the messengers before him witnessed. Muhammad ibn Abdullah, as he grew, brothers and sisters, for as a young infant, he lost his mother. And thus he grew as an orphan. He grew and was nurtured by the Sa'di tribe, and he had a wet nurse whose name was Halima al-Sa'diya, who suckled him and who nurtured him among her people. He grew, brothers and sisters, and was known to be al-Amin. He was known to be the trustworthy. He was known to be as-Sadiq, the one who was well known for his truthfulness, the one who was well known for his trustworthiness. And that individual who says concerning himself that when I was young, Allah the Most High saved me from much of that which many of the Arab fell into by way of debauchery and drinking and dancing and lewdness with women and so on. And on one occasion, it occurred to me that maybe I should go and I should experience one of these sessions that they would have of drinking and music and what have you. And so I intended, after shepherding some sheep, I intended to investigate and to partake in one of those sessions. He said that I took rest at a tree. Prior to leaving and embarking upon going there, I took rest at a tree. He said, and then before I knew it, I found myself waking up in the morning, having missed the whole night. And he said, and in that way, as I grew, Allah the Most High protected me from much of that which many of the Arab tribes were falling into. So Muhammad ibn Abdullah, when he reached the age of 25, he married his first wife, Khadija. And Khadija, brothers and sisters, was likewise a widow. And she was and had involved herself in something from trade and was known to be a woman who had entered into trade and business. And so Muhammad ibn Abdullah, he married Khadija, who was 40 years old at the time. And he took over the trade and the running of the trade for her. And she was inclined towards him and had a liking for the Messenger Muhammad because of the fact that he was known to be trustworthy, and she was attracted to that and to his truthfulness. And so Muhammad ibn Abdullah, thereon after was given to seclusion. And he would travel to the cave that was set in a mountain known as Mount Hira. And as some of the narrations mention, كَانَ يَتَحَنَّ that he would go there and he would worship in his own way. He would worship and he would take time out and he would reflect upon the creation of the heavens and the earth and upon the creation in general. And he disliked as a youth, the worship of the idols and the paganism that was practiced by the Arabs at that time. And then on that occasion, while he was in the mountain, and while he was there in that cave, he was visited by night by that angel that visited the prophets and the messengers prior to him. He was visited by the angel Gabriel, Jibril, who held him and who squeezed him until he himself said that I lost my breath and I found difficulty breathing. And then the angel turned to him and said, Iqra. He said, read. He said, I cannot read. As the messenger was an illiterate man and he was able to know that he was eloquent as far as the Arabic language was concerned, but had not the ability to read and write. He said, read. He said, I cannot read. And so he grabbed him again and squeezed him until he lost his breath. And he said again, read, Iqra. And he said, indeed, I cannot read. And so he grabbed him for a third time, squeezed him, until he was unable to breathe. And he said on a third occasion, Iqra. And he said, what shall I read? For I cannot read. And so the angel Gabriel, he said, and revealed to him the first five verses of the Quran. Iqra, bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. He said, read. Read in the name of your Lord who has created. خلق الإنسان من علق. Created mankind from a congeal clot of blood. Read. وربك الأكرم. And indeed your Lord is the most noble. The one who taught man by the pen taught man that which he knew not and then left him. And so Muhammad ibn Abdullah, upon receiving those first verses, he returned back to his wife Khadija. He ran back to her and he was disturbed and perturbed, and he informed her of that which took place and said that indeed he grabbed me three times and told me to read, and then he recited to me the following. And so the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after that period, for a period of 6 months, he would receive true dreams. For 6 months he was not revisited. And he would receive true dreams. He would witness something in a dream and then it would become manifest just as he saw it. And thereon after that 6 month period, as the messenger was slightly confused concerning what had taken place, and so Khadija, who had an uncle who was known as Waraqa, who was from the men of knowledge, from among the people of the book, among the Christians, they visited Waraqa and he informed him of that which was and that which had taken place. And so Waraqa, he responded by saying, indeed you were visited by the same angel that visited the prophets and the messengers before. And he said, if Allah gives me life, then indeed I will aid you when your people expel you. And so he responded, confused, saying, and will they expel me? And so he responded, Waraqa responded by saying, no doubt. There is not and has never been an individual that came with the likes of that which you're coming with now, with prophethood, receiving revelation, except that his people expelled him. And so thereon after, The messenger, peace and blessings be upon him, was visited again by the angel Jibreel on a second occasion. And when he visited him, he made himself apparent in his true form. That is, that he saw him in the form of an angel, just as Allah created him. As the angel Jibreel on occasions would visit him in the form of a man. And on occasions, the messenger would see him in his true form. And he explained that when he saw him on that occasion in his true form, he had somewhere in the region of 600 wings, those wings filling the horizon. And so when he saw him on an occasion, the messenger again returned, running back to his home. And he covered himself up in his blanket, afraid of that which he saw again. And so Allah the Most High revealed to him, Ya أيها المدثر قم فأنذر وربك فكبر وثيابك فطهر والرجز فهجر. He said, O ye wrapped up in thy garment, قم rise and warn, وربك فكبر and extol the virtues of your Lord, وثيابك فطهر and purify your garment and expel impurities of every type. So the messenger realized that which Waraqa informed him of was true, that he indeed was a messenger that was sent from Allah with a similar message to that which every single one of the prophets and the messengers was sent with, and that is that he should call to Allah, وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ, glorify your Lord, call to your Lord, and keep yourself pure and free of impurities. So the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he received the revelation, that revelation, brothers and sisters, was no doubt to be the beginnings of the final book and the final message that our Lord was to send to mankind. And that is that book, brothers and sisters, that we continue to have to this day. Al-Qur'an, the final message in a succession of books that were revealed from Allah, our Lord the Most High. And so Muhammad ibn Abdullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he began, brothers and sisters, and began calling to Allah. He gathered them on an occasion, his tribesmen. He rose upon a mountain and called them, saying, O Quraysh, O people of Quraysh, which was his tribe, O offsprings of Abdul Muttalib, O relatives of my tribe and my kinsmen, seek aid from Allah and turn to Allah, for indeed I am not able to help you against Allah in any way. And so the people, as Waraqa mentioned, they initially expelled him. They rejected him. Those who followed him were persecuted. And they went through all kinds of hardships and afflictions. Brothers and sisters, the messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam thereafter, his followers increased in number. And we found that from among the men and the women who followed him, there was not one of them except that they were persecuted on the basis of that. And we found, brothers and sisters, that from them, from his followers, we had individuals who were poor, individuals who were slaves. And likewise, we had the noblest from the noble and notable individuals from among the Arab, the likes of his great companion Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and Hamza and others. And so we had all types of Arab following him. And it was not just those individuals who were disadvantaged and who did not have the wherewithal to do anything except follow an individual who claims to be a messenger. No. Rather, we had individuals from all spectrums and all walks of life following the messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Many of the companions, they used to say, as was the case with Salman, that individual who went through many stages and followed many religions, that individual who was an idol worshipper at one stage, who was a Christian, who followed Judaism, and who was constantly in search of the truth, he was informed of the coming of a messenger to the region of the Arab. And so he traveled towards that region in order to witness and to meet that messenger that had been foretold. And he mentioned that when I saw Muhammad, I had to ask the people who he was, as he did not wear any garments that caused him to be different or to stand out from the people. And he mentioned that, by Allah, I swear by Allah, when I saw him, I knew that this was not the face of a liar. And likewise, we saw that the messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he began to call, we saw him calling to those characteristics of nobility that every single one of the messengers called to. He called brothers and sisters to the affair of Tawheed. And that is that he called initially, and it was the basis and the foundation of his call, that he would call brothers and sisters to the belief in one God, that one God alone deserves our worship, that one God alone we should dedicate our acts of worship to, and that we should not give anything from devotion and from dedication to other than the creator of the heavens and the earth, Allah. And it was that caused the dissension between the messenger Muhammad and his people, as was the case with every single one of the prophets and the messengers. The main issue and the main problem that they had with that prophet and with that messenger was that he would say, and that he called his people to doing away with worshipping the idols, to doing away with worshipping aspects of creation, the sun, the moon, stars, worshipping those messengers that were sent, Abraham, Moses, Jesus, and that one should focus and dedicate one's worship to the worship of one God, and that is the creator of the heavens and the earth. And that was the essence of the message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that I have been sent to you as nothing more than a messenger. I have not been sent to you that you may worship me. Rather, I have been sent to inform you of the fact that your God is one God, and that he desires from you and requires from you that you worship him alone, and that you dedicate and turn your worship towards him. He likewise called to the establishment of the prayer. As that, brothers and sisters, is the connection and the bond between the creation and their Lord. And that is something, no doubt, that every single one of the prophets and the messengers established. That connection between the worshippers, that connection between mankind and their creator by way of prayer. As Allah the Most High mentions in the Quran, "Ustaeenu bisabri wassalah," seek aid with patience, seek aid in taking care of your affairs with patience and with prayer. And so he called the people to connect themselves with their Lord, and to do away with being bondsmen of other men, to do away with being slaves of creation, to do away likewise with being slaves of themselves, and that they turn in devotion to the one that created them and the one to whom they ultimately will return. He called them likewise to giving the poor Jew, and to giving and being charitable. He called similarly to the removal of oppression and the alleviation of all types of transgression. He called to justice. He called to uprightness, righteousness. He called to the elimination of debauchery and of every type of lewd vice. He called brothers and sisters to nobility. He called to the tying of the bonds of kinship, He called to righteousness to one's parents. He called and he declared that no man has virtue over any other man on the basis of color, of the basis of lineage, other than by way of taqwa, other than by way of piety and God fearing. And so with that being the case, we saw that those who had a desire for power among the people of the Arab were from the first to reject his message and to declare him a liar, to declare him one who was a magician, to declare him one who was a poet, to declare him a soothsayer, to declare him a man who was possessed by a demon and so on. And for that reason, Allah the Most High frees him from all of those claims. Indeed, your companion is not one that is possessed. And as Allah Azza wa Jal, the Most High, he mentions in the Quran, فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. And whosoever desires the meeting of your Lord, and that was the call of Muhammad, whoever desires and believes in the meeting of his Lord, فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا, then let him work righteous deeds, and let him not ascribe a partner with his Lord, with anyone. And so while Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, was accused of those affairs, he, peace and blessings be upon him, continued to persevere, knowing that those accusations were nothing other than smoke screens. Why did they refer to him as a magician? They referred to him as a magician because they knew that that which he was given by way of this Quran and this revelation, that which it had by way of eloquence, the likes of which none of the most eloquent from among the Arabs had seen and witnessed and had heard, that that would cause and would be the cause of concern for many. That where would this individual who was illiterate, who had no sermon and no teaching from any of the people of the book, as Mecca at that time and the region in which he grew in, it did not have any individuals from among the people of the book, yani people of knowledge from among the Christians or among the Jews. Rather, that was something that was present in Medina, which was not a region that the Messenger, peace and blessings be upon him, had lived in, and was some 350-400 kilometers away from Mecca. And so, brothers and sisters, they recognize that this individual who was illiterate and who was not known for lying, neither was he known to be untrustworthy, that he would not now come and lie against Allah. And they knew that this individual who was not given to constructing poetry and being a poet, that how could he now have and now utter words that superseded and excelled the finest poetry that was present and that was constructed by the most eloquent of the poets of the Arab. And so this was a cause for concern. Similarly, that when we analyze the message that was present within that Quran, the message that was present within the book that he came with, the message was a potent one. The message was an attractive one. And that combined with the eloquence of the book would be, brothers and sisters, something that would without doubt cause individuals who were present at that time to be inclined towards it. And so in order to erect a smoke screen between Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his message, and that eloquent Quran that he had, and that revelation that he was given, they accused him of being a soothsayer and a magician. Why? That was so that when you heard that Quran, and when you were now attracted to those words, and when you were your heart was inclined towards its strong message and towards that which was present within it from eloquence, that you would remember that accusation and that you would remember that claim that in actuality he was a magician, and that this feeling that I now have of inclination towards him and his message, this that I experience within myself of or this affair of not being able to reject his message This was nothing other than the machinations of a magician, and truly, he is a very, very strong and very influential magician. And so they would turn away from his message on that basis. But even though they would accuse him of being so, we found many of the notable individuals from among the followers, from among the tribes of the Arab, that they were inclined towards his message, and many of them embraced. Many of them turned to Islam. The likes of Hamza, the likes of Umar ibn al-Khattab, the likes of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, who were individuals who, though notable, and though well-to-do and wealthy, were from among those who recognized truth, and recognized that Muhammad, this individual, who was trustworthy and truthful, prior